Well, thanks so much for being here. This is really great because I know you guys all came through horrible weather like I did. This is an idea for a talk that I've been talking about for a while. Pesticides, people really care about this, and there's a lot of attention when it comes to mosquito and tick spraying, right? So this is a really interesting topic to me, and I wanted to throw something together to help people out here, give a little bit more information. Okay, so what we're going to talk about is, first of all, why are we spraying, right? That sounds like almost like a flippant question, but it's not. It's a legitimate question. Why are we spraying for mosquitoes and ticks? What are we spraying? Good question. And there's a lot of different things that are being used, and we should discuss what they are, how they work, are they safe. One thing we definitely want to talk about is, if we're going to spend all this money and time, effort, spraying, are these methods actually effective at controlling pests and, importantly, reducing diseases, right? And we'll talk about what are the impacts on human health. Obviously, that's very important. We'll talk about ecological impacts as well, which sometimes get kind of swept under the rug. Lastly, if I'm going to tell you about problems with pesticides, I do want to make sure that you understand there are, in fact, alternative options out there, some of which were already briefly mentioned, and we'll go into more detail about those. Okay, so why are we spraying? We don't like to get bit, right? Nobody wants to get bit by mosquitoes or ticks. That includes me. A bunch of different species out there that we could be talking about, but you know, here's just a couple that are commonly nuisance insects, and ticks are not insects, or arachnids. But Asian tiger mosquito was brought over from Asia, of course, and they do transmit some diseases. In our part of the world, it's more likely that they're just going to be a nuisance. You go more tropical and you have a lot of things you have to be concerned about. Eastern wood ticks, generally not a major disease vector, but again, annoying. You know, nobody wants to get bit. Now, here's a couple more. These are more likely to be concerned for disease-based reasons. The yellow fever mosquito, shockingly, vectors yellow fever, amongst other things, right? You can get a number of diseases from those, potentially dengue as well. Aedes aegypti, also introduced invasive insect, unfortunately, all throughout different parts of the world now. The black-legged tick, which is usually called the deer tick, at least in this region, is one that's of great concern because we all know, I think you've heard, that is a major vector, the vector, for Borrelia burgdorferi or Lyme disease, right? So concern about disease is a major reason. And I want to put this into context, though, because a lot of times when we talk about diseases and concerns, those are done data-free, where people think that there's certain issues, and I want to discuss the real prevalence, what are the issues, rather than just say, well, there's diseases out there. Well, okay, let's talk about them in a little bit more detail. So Lyme disease, by the way, it's Lyme, not Lymes, although a lot of people say that, just letting you know. That was first described in the 1970s from Lyme, Connecticut, actually, that's where it gets its name. There was a cluster of cases of what appeared to be childhood arthritis, and that seemed weird, and they were able to detect the presence of the spirochete bacterium, this Borrelia, and then it was understood with time that this was, in fact, not an isolated situation, and people were getting this this disease from ticks in the region, right? So there you can see a picture of your black-legged, also known as deer tick, right there, right? Now, sometimes you get this rash, and this lets you know. If you get this bullseye rash, the erythema migrans, you get what looks like a red spot and a ring around that, and that's super distinctive. If you've got that, you should be going to a doctor because you very likely have, you know, Lyme disease. You don't have to get that. You could still get Lyme disease and not have that. About 75-80% of the time, you will get this presentation, but sometimes you don't. So just because you don't have it doesn't mean you're out of the woods, right? Now, here's the thing. People are concerned about ticks, and I can tell you that this is the only competent vector of Lyme disease. None of the other ticks we have around here can actually give it to you, right? It's possible they may be able to get the bacterium inside of themselves, but they cannot competently transfer it to you. Now, what you see here is different stages, from the little tiny nymphal stages to the adults, and they're all small because there's a dime for comparison. But one thing people often don't realize is you don't get Lyme disease just because you got bit by a deer tick. It actually has to be on you for a certain amount of time. I've probably been bit, I don't know, hundreds at least hundreds of times by deer ticks in the last 20 years. And as far as I know, I've never gotten Lyme disease, and I've tested negative a few times. And one of the reasons is I get the ticks off me. So I'm really good. Every night that I've been in the field, I check very carefully. I'm not saying you can't miss things, but it's a really important part is just to say, just because you got bit, as long as you can get these things off you within time, that really, really cuts down on your risk of the disease. In fact, it's believed it takes at least 36 to 48 hours before it's reasonably likely that you could, in fact, get the Borrelia transferred to your body, right? Okay, now, if I talk about diseases that mosquitoes and ticks cause, one thing that comes up invariably is West Nile virus. And I don't know what people really know about this. From when I talk to people, I find out that there's a lot of misconceptions. And so I want to just really briefly kind of explain what it is. This has not been here all that long. Anybody know when West Nile came into the US? Roughly? 1999, right? So it's not been all that long, right? It's been less than 20 years since it's been here. And what we'll find sometimes are birds that are dead, and then you wonder why there's a bunch of dead birds on the ground, and you can kind of trace this back to this. But West Nile virus very heavily infects certain species of birds, especially things like blue jays, grackles, crows. They get hit really hard. Now, this disease can be transmitted between birds via mosquitoes. However, you can also get the same virus by being bit by a mosquito that has picked it up from birds in the past, right? So it is possible for you to get it. Now, I will tell you this. Most of the time that you get West Nile virus, you don't even know. It's not a big deal. Okay, if you're unlucky, you might have some symptoms. It could be mild flu-like symptoms, cold-like symptoms, nothing remarkable, no different than a normal rhinovirus. Tens of thousands of people will get West Nile virus and have absolutely no reason to believe they have anything special. In rare cases, it can become serious, and it could be, in fact, potentially fatal, right? And in a small number of cases, it is. And so, you know, this affects birds very much, kills them a lot, but it doesn't tend to do that so much with us. And I want to put this in perspective, and believe me, I'm not trivializing West Nile virus. I just want to say, I think it's good to think about prevalence, and if we talk about we're trying to control something, do we want to think about what are the health concerns we get from our control measures? And we want to put them sort of in the ledger when we're looking at all these things. So just to put in perspective, here's some of the top causes of death in the United States, right? Heart disease, cancer, huge, 600,000 people a year, right? Stroke, very high. You know, you can see all those. And then we can go to some from the CDC. They're pretty low numbers, right? Boating accidents, about 600 people a year. West Nile is about 100. About 100 people a year die of West Nile. Most of them are in Texas and in California. Lightning is about 50. Cows, apparently 20. Pretty cool. I don't know how that happens, really. But whatever. Stampede, I'm not sure. Cow tipping, maybe gone awry. I don't know. But either way, about 100 people die from West Nile virus. So it's somewhere between boating accidents and lightning. And again, I'm not trivializing the 100 deaths. I'm just saying the attention that I've seen given to this, and I've tried to estimate the amount of money that we spend on this each year, just in Texas alone. I have a student who's an economic student working on this. It could very well be in the hundreds of millions of dollars to more. And so I just think it's important for us to factor in all of these things when we say, all right, it's not that it's not a real thing, but let's talk about it, you know? So just to put in perspective too, there's about 322 million people in the United States. So each year, a person has about that small number chance of dying from West Nile virus, right? Really low, low, low number. Again, it's not that it doesn't happen, but maybe our response is really out of proportion to the actual reality. So these are serious diseases, should not be trivialized. It's hard to get numbers on Lyme disease. It's extremely hard because nobody can agree on those numbers. They're very low, probably in the like dozens or less. But, and I know somebody who died of Lyme disease, so believe me, and it's not a pretty thing. But I think we need to think about this too, though. We should consider the adverse human health effects that are resulting from our control measures when we talk about this total holistic cost-benefit analysis, right? Overall, do our pesticide-based methods result in a net positive or a net negative for human health? That's something I think is really important to talk about. Okay, so what are we spraying? What are we doing to try to get rid of mosquitoes and ticks? Now, we can spray all kinds of different scales, from big military aircraft aerial deployment, like we see here, to truck-mounted sprayers, to handheld units, this whole range here, right? So I'm going to talk about different parts of that continuum. You obviously have no say, or minimal say, in the big scale spraying events that go on. I mean, sometimes the public is involved, probably not as much as they should be, but you know, directly you can't make the call on that one, but you could hire somebody to come to your house and spray, right? So that's sort of the whole continuum there. Now, one of the ones that's being sprayed on a very large scale is the chemical NALED. It is used since 1959. We've been using this to control mosquitoes in places, and the use has intensified greatly in recent years. Why do you think that is? West Nile and Zika, right? So people are very, very concerned with Zika. They're spraying unbelievable amounts of this in areas that have no Zika, never had a case, and may not for decades if ever. And it's just, it comes down to, a lot of it really is almost hysterical reaction to things. So you say, all right, what kind of efficacy does this have? How much does this cost? And is it helping anything? Is it hurting anything, right? This is a particular type of insecticide known as an organophosphate. And organophosphates work in a really cool way. They actually interfere with an enzyme called cholinesterase. Okay, this is really important in your nervous system functioning properly, whether you're a mosquito or a person, same deal. And that surprises sometimes. Sometimes people are surprised by that to find out that the exact same mechanism that it kills an insect with is the same thing it would do to you. Okay, so this isn't something that's insect specific. Now, because of what I just told you, the use of these chemicals has been controversial for sure, because the toxicity is known. Lots of people have had injuries and deaths from this, lots of famous cases. So because of this, organophosphates, a lot of the different members of that class of chemicals have been banned outright by the EPA, right? And as of 2001, nearly all types of organophosphates have been restricted for use by regular, civilians for safety concerns, right? And the World Health Organization has called for a ban on many of these different types of organophosphates. In fact, the only place where a lot of them are still used is in the United States. Almost every other country has banned many of these ones that we still use, right? So that's one class, and we'll talk about them a little bit more. Let me tell you about the other ones. Pyrethroids, these are really, really commonly used. This is a widely used class of pesticides. If you have an insecticide in your house, it's probably based on one of these, right? Many, many different kinds, all chemically related, right? When you see a lot of the over-the-counter type stuff, like wasp spray, you know, it's probably one of these. They're generally much less toxic to vertebrates than the organophosphates, but that doesn't mean there's no consequence, right? One thing we can say is they are broad spectrum. They kill insects indiscriminately. So people think, okay, well, it doesn't hurt vertebrates. Fine, okay. But you might be affecting a number of other things like pollinators, other beneficial predaceous insects, right? So whatever they come in contact with, they will kill. Now, they do break down relatively quickly. If it's sunny and it's hot and the air is still, they can break down pretty quickly, like hours to days. Under different conditions, it can take longer, but usually not much more than that. Now, sometimes you will hear people say, oh, but you know, they're natural, they're naturally derived, right? So it's true that the one chemical, which we named the whole class for, a pyrethrin, that does come from the flower of a chrysanthemum, right? So that's kind of cool, it seems natural, but don't let this whole naturalistic fallacy get you, okay? Because some other things that are natural, or the skin of cassava root has hydrogen cyanide on it, right? And castor beans produce ricin, which is one of the deadliest things out there. So just because it's natural, just because it came from a plant, doesn't mean it can't kill you, right? So just wanna throw that out there. Okay, so now let's talk about, are they effective? Are these things actually working? Because that's kind of what we're trying to do, right? If they're not doing said purpose, then we probably shouldn't use them. Okay, so let's say, does spraying work? Well, organophosphates like naled and malathion, which is another commonly used one that you can get for ground spraying, and various pyrethroids, they're all going to be used to kill the adult mosquitoes. So we refer to those as adulticides, right? And so they're going to hit mosquito body on contact. If it's a high enough dose, it will kill them, right? It tends to have very little, if any, effect on the larvae because the larvae live in the water and is not easily transmitted to the water. It is basically aerial contact and it dissipates relatively quickly. So we already know, there's lots of data on this. It's a terrible way to control mosquitoes. It's funny that we still keep doing this. According to the CDC, the US Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, they say adulticiding, application of chemicals to kill adult mosquitoes by ground or aerial applications, is usually the least efficient mosquito control technique. And we've known this for decades. This isn't news. This isn't some recent study that just came out by some advocacy groups. This has been known by pretty much everybody for a long time. So why are we still doing it? That's a really interesting question, right? There's surprisingly little scientific evidence that spraying for adult mosquitoes is effective. And most of the things that do seem to suggest it's effective are either highly restricted circumstances or they're in the journal of the American Mosquito Control Association, something where it's like, well, if you read some research that said, oh, cigarettes are fine, and it's the American Tobacco Association. You kind of question whether or not that's representative and legitimate. So I only seem to find pro-adulticide articles in very specific journals, not in sort of bigger impact journals. So I don't know. I think that's very interesting. Now, there is abundant evidence of ecological harm and adverse human effects, right, and economic costs. So again, why? Why do we keep doing this? I'd like to quote someone who went on an interview and talked about this. Because again, if you go on and you talk about this and you're in control of this decision-making process, then you know, you're responsible for what you say and what you do. And I think this is very telltale here. So Mike Doyle, who is the director of the Florida Keys Mosquito Control District, said the aerial spraying is defensible, even though in this same interview he conceded that it probably doesn't actually work. So then they asked him point blank, okay, if it doesn't work, why are you doing it? And he said, well, it's better than doing nothing. That was his literal quote, it's better than doing nothing. And he said, if you're fighting a bear and you only have a pocket knife, you should use the pocket knife. Something has to be done immediately. This is terrifying logic. This is absolutely insane, right? If you really think about what this means. No, actually, sometimes doing something that's wrong is much worse than doing nothing. And this isn't a very good analogy either. The bear and the pocket, can the pocket knife make the bear bigger? You know, that would be a better comparison. You know, so I find that to be very interesting. If the spraying is actually not getting rid of mosquitoes, but making more, as we will talk about in some cases, then no, you shouldn't do anything. And I think that's really, really telltale, is make it look like you're doing something, don't think too hard about it, maybe just do something. Bad thought process. So who else is saying the aerial spraying doesn't work? Well, hey, this guy here, okay? Dr. Michael Callahan, and it's not like he's an ecologist. It's not like he's part of some nonprofit advocacy group. If anything, he's not going to be particularly mosquito sympathetic. This is the head and the founder and CEO of the Zika Foundation, okay? And just a quote from him recently, we'll just hit some of the high points here. He said, there's been a lot of money wasted in Singapore, Taiwan, and Japan, and several Central American countries trying to control Aedes aegypti with aerial spraying. It does not work. Aerial spraying with NLED or many of the other insecticides have been proven systematically to be ineffective. They have data on this because they're trying to control Zika, okay? So ironically, in the United States, we regularly use this to control Zika in many cases where it doesn't even exist, and it's not effective. It's just not effective. But it does have some collateral damage that we get from it too. And as he pointed out here too, aerial spraying does a disservice by wiping out mosquito-eating insects. In some parts of the world, they count for 20% of the predation of the Aedes mosquito. And in fact, that's probably conservative. It's quite likely it's even higher than that. So I think that's a very interesting point. I'm really glad to hear that the head of the Zika Foundation is you know, making these statements. I don't know who's listening, but at least he's making these statements, right? So what kinds of things eat mosquitoes? Well, things like dragonflies and damselflies, right? Also known as odonates. These are predators of all kinds of flying insects, mosquitoes, other biting flies, sometimes other dragonflies and things too. It's not just mosquitoes and biting flies, but they do eat a lot of those, right? And they're able to hunt throughout their entire life stage, from really young, you know, the immatures, which are in the water, all the way up to the adults. And they can live for a few months, up to 6 years in some cases, right? They may be the most efficient predators ever studied. They basically don't miss. It's almost hard to understand why they're so perfect at it, but they're really good at capturing insects, and a lot of those end up being mosquitoes. Now, the cool thing is this. There was a study out of Japan found that the immature dragonflies probably eat a whole lot more than the adults. In just one rice field region in Japan, in the study, they found there was probably about 30 to 50,000 of the immatures of a very common type of dragonfly, right, in just a quarter acre. 95% of these, when they looked at their guts, had remains of Anopheles mosquitoes, malaria vectoring mosquitoes. So if you do this extrapolation from this, you're talking about easily, just back of the envelope numbers, several million mosquitoes per acre. But we're killing a lot of these when we spray. And amazingly, we're not killing that many mosquitoes, so it's not really helping us. These are more likely to get hit for various reasons than the mosquitoes themselves. And so it's not a good situation. It's really not. Here's a cool study that came out, which, you know, again, according to the CDC, we know it's not effective, but this one study, Howard and Oliver in New York State, they looked over an 11-year period where they were trying to target a particular mosquito that was transmitting a horse-borne disease, right? And they found that the target mosquito numbers had not only not decreased, they had increased 15-fold. Their spraying of mosquito insecticides dramatically increased the mosquito population compared to other areas where they had not sprayed. If that isn't an argument against spraying, I don't know what is. And it's not surprising because, as they noted, well, we're killing tons of beneficial insects, so yeah, that's probably why. Here's a little quote from it. Despite repetitive applications of NLED, populations of the primary vector of Eastern equine encephalitis virus, this mosquito, have increased 15-fold at Cicero Swamp. The possibility that applications of NLED contributed to increased populations of the mosquito discredits the rationale that preventive applications of NLED reduce the risk of this disease. I think it's a powerful statement. This is not an isolated study, but it was a really cool one because it was East Coast and it was relatively recent. So I just thought, wow, you know, I'm just amazed that this stuff doesn't get out more. Okay, so what about residential spraying for mosquitoes and ticks? You know, can we learn anything from that? Now, a lot of the research has been done on aerial spraying because, for obvious reasons, there's a lot more history here. We have, it's only in recent years it became a big thing of residential spraying like we're seeing now in the US. So we don't have as much data on this, and until recently there had not been as much money and resources put into this, but I can say that many of the principles will be the same. In other words, if you're spraying malathion from the air or the ground, it does the same thing to insects, right? The residual kill will be the same thing. And you know, when you're killing a lot of things in your yard, it's going to affect adjacent yards because everybody's connected. And when your neighbors are spraying for their mosquitoes, it does affect the pollinators in your yard, right? So I think this is going to be an interesting thing to look more into the research coming out of this in the coming years, for sure. Now, let's talk about the impacts on human health, right, of these various different chemicals I just mentioned to you, both the ones used in aerial and from the ground. Okay, so now the EPA has deemed that NLED's use as an insecticide outweighs its human health risks. Now, I just want to remind you that the EPA has also said the same thing for a long number of chemicals that are all banned now, because they were too dangerous. So I find there's this sort of rationalization conformance mechanism that people do a lot, where they say, oh, but it's registered with the EPA. Like, okay, you know, can I give you a list of some other things that were too, that we all know are so dangerous you can't use them? At some point, all these chemicals that got banned the day before, they weren't banned, and you could have used them. So I just find this such an interesting thought process. Oh, it's fine. They wouldn't let us use it if it wasn't dangerous. The EPA also has a very different bar than I think people think. A lot of people think that the EPA's job is to check to make sure things are safe before we use them. It is not. This shocks just about everybody, including me, when I first found this out a couple years ago. That's not it. You don't have to show something is safe. You actually have to show it's dangerous in order for it to get banned. It's a completely wrong bar. It's terrifying when you think about that. You're like, really? So they're willing, they look at the economic impacts of the chemical and say, this seems to make us enough money, we're gonna do this. Now, if you can show it's dangerous, we'll consider the science into it. And again, this is, look at what the EPA says. It's very interesting. If you go to their website, there's some really cool stuff in their FAQs. So I think that's surprising to a lot of people that they're really not actually doing a lot of what most people think they're doing, right? So they've said, oh no, it's fine. It's consistently been claimed by the EPA that the exposure levels on crops, you know, residential areas, those are safe for adults and children, right? No one else thinks this, interestingly enough. Other global organizations have come to the exact opposite conclusions in every study I could find, right? Ones by the World Health Organization, United Nations, EU, various other large nonprofit international companies, organizations. And so I find that very, very concerning that everybody else is finding these results, and then EPA is saying, oh no, it's fine. I don't know, right? It is banned in the European Union, NLED is. So now there's been very recent, this just came out this past year, really, really hard to argue against data because there have been suggestive studies in the past, but this is very tight. Recent academic research conducted in both the US and China has supported the claims that NLED spraying actually causes neurological damage to infants. It's been suspected for many years, and there was anecdotal evidence that this was happening, but it's pretty powerful data at this point now, right? So they had a long multi-year study in multiple parts of the world, and it results in significant reduction in motor function and, you know, all kinds of things, which I find is interesting too, because one of the reasons we're spraying is to control things like Zika, which causes neurological effects. Now, the chances of you getting Zika and having neurological effects from it are relatively slim, right? I mean, obviously it happens, of course. But if they're spraying this around you, then there's a really good chance that you come in contact with it. So I just, again, like I said, let's put the whole thing in the ledger and say, what's the cost? What's the benefit? Can we look at this all at once? Because people often fail to do systems thinking. They look at one thing and say, well, this kills this thing. It does this thing. Well, what's the rest of it? What's the rest of the story here, right? Dr. Claudia Miller is a physician and professor. She's at the University of Texas School of Medicine. She's had multiple federal appointments. She's very decorated. She's also been the National Advisory Committee on Occupational Safety and Health. She was on the Department of Veteran Affairs, Persian Gulf Expert Scientific Committee. There's some really cool stuff there about Gulf War disease. And she was on the National Toxicology Program Board of Scientific Counselors. She's got lots of credentials, and she's been, you know, at the highest levels here, both on the medical side and the academic research side, right? She has repeatedly stated that the EPA's insistence that NALED is safe is both wrong and irresponsible. Here's just a little bit of what she said. I'm not going to read all of it. She said, I'm a physician and a research scientist. And some of the parts here that are relevant, she said, the amount and capacity to detoxify organophosphates varies enormously, and we do not know in advance who the genetically susceptible adults or children will be, right? Several recent studies have shown the developing fetus to be especially vulnerable to organophosphates, which raises a serious question of whether we are, in a genuine effort to prevent harm to unborn babies, doing the exact opposite and threatening the health of a future generation. Prenatal exposures to organophosphates at very low levels have been shown to cause neurodevelopmental deficits. I think this is very important. You know, like I said, we only seem to focus on the one side. We should look at the whole thing. Now, here's one other cool fun fact that you probably don't want to hear. I didn't want to hear either. So I already mentioned that NALED is an organophosphate. Well, it breaks down into another organophosphate known as dichlorvose. Dichlorvose is basically nerve gas, is what it is. That's what it was developed from. We did this to kill people. We use this as a chemical weapon. And now it's coming in contact with people when organophosphates like NALED come in contact with water vapor in the air, which happens when you deploy it. Now, if you go to the EPA, there are a lot of questions about this, and they say, well, it breaks down very quickly. Okay. Well, they don't deny that it turns into dichlorvose, which is banned pretty much everywhere on Earth, because it's just so dangerous. And again, it's basically a weapon. So we're still spraying this around kids, spraying this around people, and we're just hoping that it breaks down really quick. Well, it would be good if we had a little bit more data on that. And I'm not so sure that I think that's a really reasonable risk anyway. I just don't think that's a reasonable risk. And apparently neither does Dr. Claudia Miller either. So what about pyrethroids, right? I told you they're less toxic to vertebrates. Those are safe, right? Maybe, I don't know. So very interestingly, when a lot of the organophosphates were being banned, right? They were being systematically taken off the market, or they were only allowed to be used for commercial, not residential use. We saw an uptick in the use of pyrethroids because that's what was more available, right? And so along with that, we see now more and more toxic exposures reported to various poison control centers, emergency departments, as a result of the use of the pyrethroids. So apparently they can be dangerous because the numbers keep going up every year. And this is just showing a little window between 2000 and 2005. That was a particularly relevant window because that's exactly when a few organophosphates were being phased out. So, you know, I mean, we're not talking about like a few people here, right? We're talking about in the thousands to tens of thousands per year. So I do think that, you know, maybe we should reevaluate how safe they are. And there has been a lot of concern that the Gulf War syndrome that happened during the Persian Gulf War may have been in part or largely controlled by exposure to certain groups of pyrethroids. So, because a lot of the military guys over there that would spray some of these insecticides on, they were told don't directly spray it on you or use very low doses. And it's like, I'm not gonna worry about that, I'm fine, and spray a lot. And then all of a sudden we're getting these very strange neurotoxicity issues. So, I don't know. That's kind of what we have to think about a little bit more. But, okay, let's talk about ecological impacts, right? Now, NALED, malathion, various pyrethroids like resmethrin and all these different ones, these do not discriminate. they don't really care. They can kill all insects. So if you spray it for mosquitoes and there's, you know, dragonflies nearby, butterflies, various pollinators like that hoverfly, those are all going down the same way, right? Some of them may even be more susceptible too. Unfortunately, some groups may be more susceptible than others, but they're all going to be killed on contact. They don't need to ingest it. They don't need, this isn't specific to the biology of certain types of flies like mosquitoes. No, they all, it hits the exact same pathway in all these different insect groups. And insects are doing quite a lot for us, and I give talks on this, but many of the things insects do keep us alive, right? If you lose insect diversity, you're losing major, major ecosystem services, the ability to recycle nutrients, create new soil, break down wood and turn logs into soil, all of these types of things, be food for other things up the chain. Insects are a huge part of the existence of life on Earth. So just indiscriminately killing all kinds of insect species in an area is almost certainly a very bad thing, right? And of course, this is an Audubon-sponsored talk. You know, you don't have birds without insects. This is a well-known thing. The vast majority of birds eat insects at some point in their life, right? Terrestrial birds is like 96%. Even the ones that eat seeds usually eat insects at some point, even if it's only to feed their young during development. And so if you want birds, if you like birds, like this beautiful Blackburnian warbler, you're not gonna have those when you just start indiscriminately killing insects and watch not only insect diversity go down, but insect abundance go down as well, right? Okay, so what do we see? Ooh, some stuff we wish we didn't see, right? Mosquito spraying for West Nile virus and Zika is likely a significant cause of pollinator decline. Here's one particular case study, and I thought I'd limit it to one for time reasons. In late August 2016 in Dorchester County, South Carolina, there was a miscommunication and they weren't supposed to spray, but somebody got a plane and sprayed anyway. And there's all kinds of questions about how these kinds of things can happen. But anyway, so somebody missed a memo and they went up, and even though they weren't supposed to, they sprayed a lot of NALED over the county, right? The next morning, the damage was staggering. And this is just the damage that we counted, not all the stuff that happened. They found 2.3 million dead honeybees the next morning. Lots of people were very upset about this, as you can imagine. And I imagine that that's like the tip of the iceberg, because we care about honeybees since everybody knows they're pollinators and they're managed pollinators. We have money tied up in them. But how many non-honeybee pollinators were killed by this too? I'm sure it's staggeringly higher than that number, because that's just such a small part of the total diversity, right? Here was a little article from the next morning. Like it's been nuked. Millions of bees dead after South Carolina sprays for Zika mosquitoes, right? And I won't do the emotional plea stuff here, but there's like parts of this article where like kids are crying, watching all the bees rolling over and dying and stuff. But I mean, it is a really pretty drastic thing. It really is. It's a pretty drastic thing, right? Now, this is gonna be in litigation for decades, because whoops. Okay, well, entire people lost their entire livelihoods, right? People that had organic farms, good luck. You know, what are you going to do? Good luck in anything certified for a while, right? Beekeepers lost everything they had. All these people, you know, it really affected their lives. And so there's all kinds of lawsuits going on. And, you know, I don't know. It's obviously pretty drastic situation. It's been known for decades that organophosphates like NALED and malathion are not only highly toxic to bees and other pollinators, but pretty much everything else too, right? Because they're organophosphates, they do affect everything that has essentially a nervous system, right? So this is just showing you the toxicity to fish. And there's a bunch of fish on this page you can see, like bluegill sunfish, right? People sometimes go fishing for those, rainbow trout, other things. And, you know, they range from moderately toxic to very highly toxic. And we're not talking about a lot of toxin needed. Anybody know what PPB stands for? Parts per billion is the amounts we're talking about to kill. To be 30 parts per billion is very highly toxic to bluegill sunfish, okay? Now, if they just sprayed over an area that's near water, you know, that's gonna potentially have some impacts here, right? So, okay, told you some stuff here that, you know, hopefully made an impact. Let's talk about alternative options beyond just spraying. So this is gonna sound interesting maybe, it might be surprising to some, but a really good defense against pest and disease is to have a diverse ecosystem in your yard. I'm not just saying that because I think that sounds cool. There's actually really good data on this too, right? We'll talk about that a little bit. Increasing the native plant and insect diversity really can help. Now, let's go back to our Lyme disease situation here, right? There's our deer tick. And again, why we call them deer ticks, or one of the common names, is because, well, of course, they bite deer. So everybody thinks that deer are the problem, right? They're getting the disease from deer. And, you know, if there weren't so many deer, we wouldn't have so much Lyme disease, right? Yeah, I know a lot of people think that. That's actually not true. It might be surprising. Who here that didn't make that brochure with me knows what the actual major reservoir for the Borrelia is? It's a different mammal. Yes, specifically the white-footed mouse, right? It's this cute little thing here. I mean, they are cute. You know, we're not going to deny that, right? But white-footed mouse is a really, really bad one. And so they're just dramatically overpopulated. I'm not mad at the mouse. I'm not saying, you know, but they're overpopulated. And they're overpopulated because of changes to the ecosystem. That's the thing. They're here because we've reduced biodiversity and we've created conditions that allow them to outcompete other species, only because of the reduction of the normal checks and balances that we have. So again, it seems weird to say it, but having a more diverse ecosystem actually mitigates a lot of problems. Let me give you a little bit more about what's going on here, right? A number of recent studies have found that areas with high densities of invasive honeysuckles, like Japanese honeysuckle, bush honeysuckle, Japanese barberry is one of the worst, and burning bush, have exceptionally large white-footed mouse populations, and deer as well, and a very high incidence of Lyme. So that's really interesting. Why? Well, because a lot of these things create structures that are very valuable for the white-footed mouse to be able to make nests and hide in. If anybody's ever tried to pull out a Japanese barberry, you know how fun that is, right? So things don't want to get into that tangle at the base. It's horrible, right? And it works. So it's very easy for them to get away from their predators. The lack of diversity means other species of plant diversity means other species tend to not be there, and so the mammal diversity follows as well, right? So a more diverse area containing more natives and fewer invasives will not support as many disease reservoirs. In fact, there's a name for this. It's such a consistent pattern in nature, we call it the dilution effect. So that's pretty cool. Now, what you can really say at this point is, with no hyperbole, having things like Japanese barberry, Japanese honeysuckle, literally increases the risk of Lyme disease. It's not just that these are invasive species that, like, oh, well, they're, you know, they're not supposed to be here, or they're hurting some of our native plants. No, they're increasing the chance of a potentially fatal disease by having them. They're banning them in some places, and it's very hard to make it happen because the horticultural industry fights it tooth and nail every single step of the way. So unfortunately, and that bothers me, but anyway, here's some really high-profile papers discussing this. This isn't just, don't believe me, listen to some of these people who are writing these articles in amongst the most respected journals in the world. PNAS is the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences of the United States of America, one of the most respected journals on earth. And in this article, they say biodiversity inhibits parasites, broad evidence for the dilution effect. And they have all these different meta-analyses showing that the more species that you have, the lower your disease rates are for humans and animals that humans take care of. Here's a great one. Host is ecological traps for the vector of Lyme disease. Now, let me explain what that means. So when there are a bunch of different species of mammals, some of them not only are poor reservoirs for the disease, but they actually kill ticks. Things like, what's the marsupial that we have, the only one? Yeah, possum, thank you. Virginia possum, right? They actually eat ticks. So they like rip them off, and they can do that. So they apparently have a measurable impact on reducing tick populations. Not only are they not contributing to the problem, they're reducing the problem. And that's what they mean by ecological trap. The ticks are trying to get on them and dying in the process, right? So that's really cool. But again, when you've only got a couple of species of mammals, and one of them is white-footed mouse, unlikely to be the case. Here's another. Invasive honeysuckle eradication reduces tick-borne disease risk by altering host dynamics. How great is that? Hey, if we start restoring environmental areas and we make a more natural native habitat, we actually get rid of some of the risk of disease. What do you need? You know, that's great. It's an ecological argument, an economic argument, all kinds of things, right? Here's another one. Reduction in Lyme disease risk is economic benefit of habitat restoration, right? So I could show you a bunch more, but I just picked some that were in high profile journals, right? So one last little study here showed a link between loss of biodiversity and increased Lyme disease cases. So again, looking at the other side, having more diversity means lower Lyme disease. This is saying as you're actively losing it, you know, because of, again, building housing developments or whatever, it seems to increase the chance of Lyme disease. I find this very interesting and ironic too, because I was involved in a particular township that wanted me to talk to them. But they said, well, if you make these natural, these wild areas, we'll have too many deer and we'll have too much Lyme disease. That'll be a problem. It's the exact opposite, right? The more natural your areas are and the more diversity you have, the lower your chance of these things. And they very much have an inverse relationship between the number of Lyme cases and the diversity of mammals, lizards. The bird one was a little bit wonky. It was kind of all over the place. There's a general trend down. But so that's kind of interesting, right? Makes sense to me, but I know that most people don't realize this. So, taking this to West Nile too, recent studies have shown a strong association between areas of high West Nile virus outbreaks and low bird diversity. Everybody here is cool with this. More birds is better, and it also means lower West Nile virus. And the reason is this: not all species of birds are equally good at getting West Nile virus, and they're not competent reservoirs and vectors for this, right? Some birds like blue jays, grackles, crows, very, very, very likely to be infected and act as a reservoir for the virus. So when you have a more diverse community of birds, those outlier species are a much smaller part, right? And that's a big part of this. Again, the dilution effect. So biodiversity decreases disease risk. Okay, how do you increase biodiversity, specifically bird diversity? We know that birds are linked to insects, and we know that insects are linked to plants. So it starts from the bottom. This is the sort of Doug Ptolemy sort of revival hero of using native plants. He came up with this whole movement, basically, of doing this. So you have the native plants, you have more insect diversity, you have more bird diversity, and you have lower disease rates. What's bad about that? It's all good. I think that's all good stuff, right? So if anybody's interested, I do have this list of what I think are some of the best, most ecologically valuable native plants for the mid-Atlantic. These are certainly not the only things that are valuable, but these are very good, right? If anybody's interested in that. Okay, so other things you can do. Try to cut down on the habitat for mosquitoes. You're trying to make better habitat for everything else, make worse habitat for mosquitoes, right? And so when you have tires sitting around and those tires are on an angle and they collect water, those little bits of water, those little stagnant pools, those can really be great breeding grounds for mosquitoes, which is something you don't want, right? And they don't need much time. They only need a couple weeks to go through the whole life cycle, right? So you really do want to make sure to not have something like that. This obviously goes for buckets as well. So that's something, you know, that you can actively do, try to keep that from happening. What about repellents? Don't get bit. Can't get disease if you don't get bit, right? And a lot of this is just you don't want to get bit anyway. So what kinds of things can we use to prevent nuisance, insects, and disease? Which of them work? So this is kind of cool. I tried to find actual research on this, not just like, hey, what people seem to say. And this is from a study where they looked at the amount of these Aedes aegypti mosquitoes and another species. It was what? Aedes albopictus as well. And they looked to see how many of them got trapped in the hand with these different glass tubes to see which they were more attracted to, right? And so some of them were based on DEET. The first three that I'm showing you there with an arrow are based on DEET. The Cutter lemon eucalyptus insect repellent was based on this lemon eucalyptus oil. And then I find this to be so interesting. Victoria's Secret Bombshell was highly repellent to mosquitoes as well. That was really not something they expected to see. So yeah, basically, when you go to the other species, very similar patterns, except for the one EcoSmart organic insect repellent also ended up becoming significantly lower number of mosquito bites, even up to 120 minutes and even up to 240 minutes. That did not happen with the other species of mosquito. So the ones in red were very effective for at least 120 minutes or more for both species of mosquito, right? And this goes along with what the CDC has said as well. Basically, if you want to get rid of mosquitoes, or if you don't want them to bite you, I should say, DEET-based sprays are great, although a lot of people don't like DEET and have concerns about safety. So the very viable alternative is anything based on lemon eucalyptus oil, right? I personally prefer that anyway, because I think it smells and feels a lot better. I hate the feel of DEET. I just don't like it. Also, when I used to have cheap plastic watches, it dissolves the face of the watch, by the way. If anybody's ever... Okay. But anyway, those are the only two that recommend recommended by the CDC. They did not recommend Victoria's Secret Bombshell, but amazingly, it was almost as effective as something we designed to be an insect repellent. I love the article, it's great. Surprisingly, the perfume we tested, Victoria's Secret Bombshell, has shown to be a strong repellent with effects lasting longer than 120 minutes. It must be noted that the concentration of perfume we used in this test was rather high, and the lower concentrations of the same fragrance might have different effects. So coat yourself in Victoria's Secret and you will be fine. I don't know. I would like to see another follow-up study with a bunch of different perfumes, because wouldn't that be cool? You're like, double up, cologne, perfume, don't get bit, all kinds of good stuff, right? Okay, now people will ask me, what about targeted pesticides or larvicides? We don't really talk about larvicides so much because we're really talking about spraying, right? So instead of going for the adults, you could do things that you put in the water that kill the young mosquitoes. These are usually more effective, but they can come with some cost too. And so you'll see these things. Mosquito Dunks is one of the brands that are out there. Sometimes people say, oh, they're organic, or I don't know if these are considered organic or not because it's a very slippery definition. But these may or may not be considered organic, but you know, they can work too. If they kill broad spectrum, if they kill a bunch of insects, then the insects will be thrilled they died organically, but they'll still die, right? So if you're trying not to kill insects, you know, a pesticide, you have to think about the consequences there, right? However, some of these are more specific. These ones, they don't kill all insects. These are based on a particular extract from one type of soil inhabiting bacterium that only kills the larvae of mosquitoes and other flies. Unfortunately, it does also mean other flies. And some of those other flies are basically fish food. So, you know, I've heard people greenwash this to death. They say, oh, it's fine, it doesn't kill anything but the mosquitoes. No, it does. If you're gonna be talking about rain barrels, awesome, no problem. You talk about like a fish pond, fine, you know, whatever. If you have a natural pond or lake nearby, I really would ask you not to use these, because they did a study at University of Missouri and they found it did measurably cause a decline in amphibian populations there because it takes their food. It's, oh, it's not toxic to vertebrates. Right, it just makes them starve, which they're happy they died from starving instead of toxicity. No, it doesn't matter, right? So just, you know, that's something to think about, is these may be more targeted and not as bad, you know, but it's not like they have no consequence. Now here's one that people have asked me about, and I know people have visceral reactions when you mention genetically modified organisms. So one new technique is to use GMO insects, which means that we've modified something about them from a wild type of insect by directly manipulating the genome. Now, we're not going to get into long discussion about that, and my quick comment on this is there are times where that is a very dangerous thing and times where it's a very not dangerous thing, okay? And you have to take it on the science and the case by case. You know, I hear people say, oh, GMOs are always bad and GMOs are totally safe, and neither of those are true, right? So let's look at the science on this, right? Now, how does this work? It's actually pretty ingenious. Here's the idea. You take your mosquito that you want to control, right? They've inserted a gene. We won't get into the whole mechanics of how they do that, right? But you insert this gene and it kills all females, right? Now it kills females unless a genetic repressor is present, in this case, tetracycline. So you give them a low, very, very low dose of antibiotics, tetracycline while they're feeding, right? As soon as you pull, you can build your big population, as soon as you pull away the repressor, all the females are dead. All you have left are males. Males can't bite, by the way, only females can. And so you can then release these males, which have a ticking time bomb in them, right? They have a gene that is dominant lethal, meaning every single offspring that gets it dies as long as they're female. What's gonna happen? Very quickly, you're gonna see a catastrophic decline in the population of this species because the males go out, all their female offspring are dead, and then just, it's really, really quick. It can be 90% reduction in population in just a few applications of this. And so now my brain does this thing, which is, that sounds good, but what's wrong with it? Why can't I like this? Why well, I can't like this, why? And then I go through everything, and you know, I'm a scientist, I have a background, I studied genetically modified organisms during my master's, and that particular system was scary. And you know, I'm aware of lateral gene transfer, that could be a scary thing. Genes, you can't transfer this. It kills everyone who gets it. There's no way to spread something that's fatal, right? So it's what it would do, the only negative outcomes you could have for this, and this is stretching, is, well, antibiotic resistance, it's trivial compared to hand soaps, okay? The antibiotic hand soaps, it's very little. And they're like, well, what if it caused a total crash of this already invasive species of mosquito? I guess that's not bad either. So, I mean, they're not like these are integral parts of the ecosystem when you're talking about Aedes and Anopheles mosquitoes that were never in this part of the world anyway. So I literally cannot come up with, I've talked to a bunch of molecular biologists, ecologists, various people, and this is actually a really ingenious idea. And so unfortunately what happens is people conflate things. They say, well, I don't like that when Monsanto does this genetically modified thing, which I generally agree and understand, but this is different. And you know, you have to look at the science behind it and say, what is the difference between the effects of this, which has essentially no collateral damage, versus spraying toxins that kill everything but mosquitoes and cause known health defects and all kinds of ecological problems and economic problems. And you say, it's really not like it's a close, you know, it's not hard to make a decision here. But in South Florida, they've gone over this one a bunch of times. You know, should we spray more in the lead, or should we spray, or should we use genetically modified insects? And the articles in the papers are extremely telltale, because they're like, should we use Franken insects? It's all this, like, emotional stuff, and you're like, you know, and so they're like, no, let's use the stuff that's known to cause birth defects in children. You know, like, that's not a great, you know, that's not a good side of that one. So you see this sometimes, unfortunately. So what I want to end with is this awesome picture that I found that I couldn't believe. Here's the picture of a jumping spider eating a mosquito that just fed on somebody's arm. That's amazing. I cannot recommend using giant legions of jumping spiders on your back to control mosquitoes, but if I could, I would totally do that, you know. Okay, do you guys have any questions? So first of all, the BTI, the active chemical in there, is not particularly long term. It does break down relatively quickly. In sunlight, it breaks down very quickly. So if you use it to water stuff, it's not going to last long. It would kill any fly larvae that were there. Most fly larvae are in water, so or very, very wet areas. So the chances are you would have pretty minimal impacts, especially if you waited. It probably wouldn't make much of a difference at all, to be honest. Well, it really depends on what's in them. Some of them do have insecticides bundled in with the, because there's all kinds of things that can be in these, right? They can have herbicides and fungicides and different things, and they're fertilizers. And so, you want to look at the label, but many of those things do have adverse impacts on insects, because a lot of them have grub killers in there, right? So the grub killers will kill things like Japanese beetles, which is not a bad thing. The question just becomes how many ground beetles are you killing too? And ground beetles eat other types of pest insects very often. So I don't know. I couldn't tell you what the percentages are, but the only thing I can tell you is in my yard, I don't use any of those things. I don't bag when I mow the lawn. It still looks pretty good because I have a decent mower that the fine, you know, the pieces of grass go back into it. And I've never used anything like that. And I have incredibly high densities of ground beetle populations, which got rid of my slug problem. So I've never, and before I moved in, apparently they had major slug problems around there. Because when I first year we got in there, you couldn't walk through the yard. Everything was just slugs all over everything. So had I used something that killed a bunch of grubs in the ground, I may still have that same slug problem. I'm not sure. I'm not sure, I'll be honest with you. I'm not really that much of an expert on them. I'm not really sure. I've seen them in residential neighborhoods where I don't think it was particularly diverse, but I don't know how likely they are to stay. I think just as a general diffuse kind of like, there's gonna be more species of mammals. I don't know anything about opossums specifically attracting. Any other questions? All right, well, thank you very much.